My brief was to talk about writing and reading and texts as they're used and involved in, for me, will mostly be Roman religion, though I'll talk a bit about other religions of the ancient Mediterranean, and to use that as a jumping-off point for thinking about how that works in relation to early Christianity and other traditions that make new uses or different uses of the text. The starting point really for the modern discussion of literacy is William Harris's book of 1989 entitled Ancient Literacy. And most of the books I mention will appear somewhere on this handout. I promise not to mention all the books on the handout, and I'll probably end up mentioning a few that aren't on there, for which I apologise, but you know how it goes. From the point of view of ancient historians of the Greek and Roman world, there has been a consistent interest in literacy since the early 60s. And it, like anything else we're consistently interested in, it kind of flares up occasionally and then sort of dies down for a bit. And so I'm not going to take you in a sort of awful bibliographical survey blow by wretched ancient historical blow from the past to the present. But I thought it would be useful to start a little bit by talking about the general framework of literacy, particularly because it touches on those questions that John mentioned when he invited me, questions about who could read what and what a text used for and how new are the uses of text and the use of reading and writing within non-ancient or non-classical religious traditions. William Harris is a professor at Columbia, trained in Oxford. He's made an enormous range of contributions across ancient economy, books on shipping, on the emotions, on imperialism, mostly Roman, sometimes the whole of antiquity, and is currently sort of leading a huge set of projects on ecology and environmental history. He's one of the most creative people I know in my discipline. I'm rather fond of him. So although I'll have him on the slab for a little bit, I don't want this to seem that I'm either attempting to downplay what's a really important achievement, his contribution, nor that I don't think he's got important things to say to us now. And if you do look through the bibliography of on low reading levels, that Harris is still slugging it out. Harris 2014, putting people right, and Muritzen putting people right in a different direction. So that's what I mean by live debate. What William argued was that literacy levels in the ancient world, from Homer to Augustine, are low. And he argued this in a polemical mode, because at least to him it seemed, I think he was right, that at the time people overestimated the levels of literacy in the classical world. And he thought classicists, with their approach to an ancient world through poetry and literary texts, were particularly likely to be soft-headed about this, and particularly likely to imagine that everybody wanders around Pompeii and Rome and so on with their heads full of Virgil and Homer. Many of them did, in fact, wander around with their heads full of Virgil. But if you look at the record of graffiti of Virgil, which are very, very large numbers from the ancient world, you find almost all of them come from Book One, which suggests that quite a lot of people, you know, did the school prescription and didn't get very much further. So our great angst about, you know, the dramatic ending of Book 12 and whether or not Aeneas killing Turnus represents a fundamental lack of faith in the Augustan project is something that wouldn't have occurred to any of these guys who are sitting there scratching Arma et Virum Cano, will this do Ed, on the walls of Pompeii. William's argument I've summarised here, and like all summaries, it's a blunt summary, and it's a very readable book. So he's arguing literacy is low compared to today. Well, that's uncontroversial. That literacy levels are actually high relative to places like ancient Egypt and societies where the nature of the writing systems or the social structure or both meant that we're really only dealing with texts created by a tiny proportion of scribes. And he then attempts, I think probably less successfully, to estimate periods in which literacy rises and falls. And these broadly correlate with periods where there are more cities or more governments. So, you know, classical Athens, more people read than archaic Athens. The Roman Empire, more read than in the Greek world, when cities shrink in late antiquity. And I think that bit is so difficult to demonstrate or test that you can take it or not. The real point, I think, is the way in which his argument here depends so much on indirect evidence. He does, in fact, talk about a very large number of texts, though inevitably I know classicists who say he missed the text they really cared about. And he does take all this into very careful account, and he started, in fact, from Graffiti in Pompeii. But the main argument, I think, is an argument that mass literacy, in the sense we understand, is something that's really only imaginable in a world with near universal education, a world in which you have to be able to read and write to manage, a world like our own, where people who cannot read are forced to dissimulate reading at the cost of huge social shame, where they rely on other people to read for them, where they're going along to secret adult literacy sessions because they're embarrassed that their children and their partners, how poor their skills are. And Harris is right. That world in antiquity is unimaginable. And so from that point of view, it's correct. What it does, of course, is it says the downside of an argument like that, as you say, antiquity, ancient levels of reading are not like modern levels of reading because the ancient world wasn't modern. And he actually uses rather more pages than that. Why does this debate matter? Why was it a big issue at the time? Well, outside the tiny little world of classics, it's a big issue because in the 60s onwards, I don't know whether you've had people who've talked about the work of Jack Goody and Walter Ong. Has that been raised in the seminar? Yes, a little bit. So this is a movement from a range of different directions, anthropology, education, and so on. And particularly a set of ideas that claim that literacy is absolutely fundamental variable in human societies, that Goody talks sometimes of a great divide between societies that are literate and those that are not. If you are a particular Parisian structuralist frame of mind, you can associate with sort of raw, cooked, and so on. I had a friend in Cambridge when I studied there who would parody to say up, down, left, right, raw, cooked, half-baked. But from the point of view of Goody and Ong, in very different ways, actually, Ong is in some ways more subtle and less imaginative. So the various kind of literary hypotheses take different forms. Some of them are societal and some are individual. And the societal one is that writing does, in fact, tend to be essential for complex states, that if you live in a big state, sorry, typo there, you need quite a lot of literates to run it. If you're going to have a tax system, an education system, governmental control, people need to manage this. And there's, I think, some quite interesting arguments about the way in which governmental literacy generates a kind of responsive literacy on the behalf of others. And perhaps a particularly nice example in this context is the Barbatha Archive, which some of you may know, in which someone who seems to be a very relatively low state, her personal archive of documents found in the Negev desert, Judean desert. Within what was then been the Roman province of Arabia for a very short period, less than a generation. And she has wills and personal documents and so on. What's clearly happened is that if you are being governed in the Roman Empire in a relatively muscular way, you need to keep your tax receipts and your bank statements. And if you got divorced, you should keep your divorce papers and so on. Now, how typical this is, of course, is extremely difficult to know. Even in modern times, some of these things are honoured more in the observance than the breach. In the wake of Brexit, my brother has put huge amounts of energy into finding Irish grandparents, and in an excess of genealogical zeal, discovered that one of our grandparents was married a couple of times during the lifetime of her husband, without any divorces occurring. And she clearly just moved to the next town and said, "I'm sorry, I'm single," changed a few names on the birth certificate. In those days, probably this was quite an easy and common thing to do. So I don't think we should go overboard on governmentalism and literacy. But we can see the kind of correlations being made here. Much more controversial are the claims about how literacy affects the fate of individuals. Again, these work much better in a modern world. Yes, it's true, if your kids can't read, they're going to have a tough time getting into university. Once they're there, they'll be fine, but getting in is going to be tricky, and getting a good job as well. So from that point of view, literacy is important for individuals. And then the particularly controversial idea is that literacy is kind of like a really rough workout at tennis. It raises your cognitive ability. Once you're literate, you can do big sums in your head and imagine abstractions and so on. And I think that particular claim has been very, very effectively shot to pieces. The point of these is that these claims are floating around at the time where people are worrying about literacy and inevitably being applied to ancient societies. The most famous paper is, in fact, one by Goody and Watt, talked about the consequences of literacy, and they saw a very simple cause and effect. Writing's invented in ancient Greece, more people become literate, and this kickstarts the intellectual revolution, so-called, of classical Greece, philosophy, rhetoric, history, mathematics, science, medicine, all goes down to literacy. And then they went off and looked at other societies, India, China, and tried to spot the moment at which literacy had suddenly pushed these societies up to a new level. Since that, there have been a number of responses. I put some of them on the handout here. Graphs, very, very good ethnography of 19th century North American cities, showed that often it isn't the most literate people who are most successful. There are other resources that tend to co-vary with success much more than literacy. Havelock was quite pro this. Street is probably the most effective demolition of these literacy hypotheses, pointing out to the highly ideological role of them, and particularly, I think, if there's one thing that comes out of all of this, it's a strong sense that if we're to understand writing, we have to understand in context. Literacy can't be an absolute value. We have to understand what are the uses to which writing's put? What are the social consequences? So it may be that writing systems have particular potentials, I suppose now we call them affordances, in terms of actor network theory, that certainly there's things you can do in societies or places or times or whatever if you're literate that you can't if you're not, but that we really do need to think about those times and places and those social contexts to make sense of it. And that's what I will be doing in the rest of this paper, trying to think about the particular uses and contexts and so on in which writing ends up being used in all ancient religions, but often in very different ways. And so I will be siding with Street and with Rosalind Thomas and others, very much sort of stressing that kind of approach. I'm sure you know the background to how writing systems work. Okay, so writing systems, they've been invented around the world in a number of different places. There are, depending on what you call a writing system, there might be a few states that don't have writing, and a few, but it's pretty unlikely. Perhaps the biggest advances that have been made here in recent years have been by Mesopotamianists, by cuneiform specialists, who've pointed out that many early systems, and this also applies actually if you look at the New World, that what comes first is not an attempt to freeze speech, but there are notational systems, counting systems, ways of looking at measures and quantities. And many writing systems, in fact, have very little of a phonetical element. Now, even in the 80s and 90s, we've been quite used to treating orality and literacy as two parallel and equivalent entities. That we have two ways of communicating. I can speak, vocalising my thoughts. John hears them, understands them, and thinks about them. Or I could send him an email, he reads it, and these are regarded as essentially sort of parallel alternative modes of communication. And I think more and more we're realising that that's not necessarily the case. I mean, it's not necessarily the case for a start, and it's very difficult to think of what the equivalent of illiteracy would be for orality. They're not the same shape, these two concepts. But it's more important that treating them together puts at the centre of it a verbalised form of communication. We're actually aware in our everyday life that we communicate constantly in non-verbal ways, whether we're present or whether we're absent, and that's true for all other animals as well, of course. In the ancient world, it seems that ways of counting out quantities and making lists and so on was actually much more important. And if you think about a system like Egyptian hieroglyphic, Akkadian, there will be users who are unable to convert that into speech, even if they tried, and who would not understand, and who would not understand a spoken version of the text, because ideograms have no single sound equivalent. So it's very much from the point of view of our current writing systems, most of which tend to privilege phoneticism, that we tend to think of speech and writing as somehow parallel. You could even, I think, go further, I've argued elsewhere, and say, well, literacy should really be best understood as an innate human capacity to use, organise and think in terms of signs, and that sometimes we use those signs for to represent speech, but often not. And if you think about something like, say, linear B, where a text would maybe have on it something like sign for sheep, then some numbers, and then a name at the end of it, This can't be translated into speech. What you can do is say, if somebody understands the purpose for which this document is made, they will know what that name is associated with that thing is, whether it's an owner or somebody who it's destined for, and you might then be able to boil this up to something like 40 sheep belong to Agamemnon. But you need to supply a huge amount of context. There's absolutely, most of those words don't have any representation in the text. And what we're really looking at is a sophisticated sign system. And I submit most of the text that we generate today are very largely texts that don't have a phonetical element. So most of the handwritten texts I write very few because my handwriting is so terrible. Ask something like a shopping list that says, you know, coffee, cornflakes, cream crackers, and then in larger bold capitals, read the meter. Okay? And I think a lot of ancient texts we should think of that way, where the size of letters, format, shape of document, numbers, bullet points, those things are actually much more important than attempting to turn an utterance into a well-formed paragraph. So these are non-alphabetic systems, something to rest your eyes on for a moment. Cuneiform on the right and hieroglyphic on the left. One reason to put them up is because they both lasted amazingly efficiently for thousands of years. And before we get into a kind of evolutionary sort of kick where we imagine people are desperately groping towards phoneticism and just taking a really, really long time to get there, we should remember that Sumerians, successive Assyrian empires, many other kingdoms, in fact, Hittites, used cuneiform and so on very effectively for a very long time. This is my equivalent of sort of dinosaurs live a lot longer than we have type slide, okay? Most of our modern systems, I'm sure you know, are derived from a single innovation, an abjab, that's to say an alphabet without vowel sounds, developed by the Phoenicians or West Semites, or various names are given to this group. And with the Greek addition of vowels, it spreads all over the West, Greek, Latin, Cyrillic alphabets and so on, and thence out to our colonial worlds, and in the East, Aramaic, Arabic, and so on. And I'm sure that's all familiar, but just to make the point, here's a nice picture. There's this particular slide calls them Phoenicians, and it shows how the alphabets have sort of drifted off into a wide range of well, these are just the early versions. This more or less sort of stops. I don't know what modern Latin means, but I mean, it's certainly sort of, this is only a tiny subset of the different versions that have originated from this. There's no real consensus over why this system becomes popular. For those who think that it becomes popular because it's fantastically efficient for successful economies and political systems, I say to you, Japan. For those who think that it's for those who think it's about association with languages of power, well, maybe it is, or even perhaps the systems that are easier to write with a pen than inscribe. I think having a small number of characters does give it the potential to be used by large numbers of people, but certainly not every society that has used writing has had mass literature, anything like it. The number of surviving texts from pre-Roman Gaul, France, is under 50. So this is a population, an enormous population, who used writing for 100 years or so before the Romans came. So we shouldn't imagine that as soon as you've got an alphabet, everybody can read. It doesn't work like that. Greater phonetic precision, maybe there is something about that. Although actually, as soon as I wrote that, I realised when I put the last paragraph that phonetic systems have been done, syllabic systems have been run a couple of times using cuneiform. And again, in Japan, there are different ways of combining systems if you want to do it. And finally, the main media and tools with which I'm writing is used in the ancient world, monumental inscriptions on a range of media. Strangely, the ancients thought of the hierarchy of materials equivalent to permanence. So when Horace says, I've made a monument, more lasting than bronze. He means, you know, my poem will last longer than the bronze inscription. We have almost no bronze inscriptions. You can melt them down. We have few marble ones because you can melt them down too in lime kilns. Granite's a bit more tricky. And then perhaps what we underestimate is the vast number of these portable and ephemeral texts. Most of them perished, but wherever you look in detail in the right context, either waterlogged context, like under the Bloomberg building in London, where the new batch have just appeared from early Roman London, or in Hadrian's Wall. So anywhere with anaerobic conditions, you get wooden materials. In the deserts, you've got writing on ostraca. People are constantly generating tiny short lists, and they're all like my list, which says coffee, cornflakes, cream, crackers, and read the meter. They're really, really short texts, which have no prose. Jim Adams, the greatest expert on regional Latin, looked at the ostraca from Buan Gem, and he wondered, yeah, whether there's a bit of Punic interference in some, but his main conclusion, I think, was that these guys would stand absolutely a snowball's chance in the hot place if they had to sit a GCSE Latin. You know, ancient standards of grammar and orthography and spelling and so on were, you know, desperately, desperately subpar. So much for writing, so I want now to look a little bit at how it's used in terms of the religions of the Greeks and Romans. I'm going to talk a bit about the kind of text that he used as props, as tools and so on. And then I'm going to talk about writing as itself a ritual activity. And by that I mean, well, I suppose I subscribe to the anthropology of religion that says that ritual... It's more helpful to think about ritualization than about rituals, that you can take particular activities and ritualize them in ways that give them a greater significance, and that we can talk a little bit about the cognitive processes connected if you're interested, but certainly come to be locally and socially associated. So looking at about writing as a ritualized activity, and if you want a quick idea to hold in your head before I get there, when you sign a contract, and somebody else has to write next to you that they've seen you sign the contract. And that, yeah, the fact that it's done in holograph, that you can't type it, that somebody else needs to say they've seen it, and that person, yeah, or when someone signs a passport photo, they've got to be a university professor or teacher or minister of religion or something. These are essentially non-rational ways we use writing. And that's what I mean, I suppose. But and then I'm going to talk a bit about how Romans wrote about ritual, and then finally come on to draw some contrast to the kind that John mentioned to begin with. So, from a very early stage, we know that writing is used in Roman religious locations, Greek religious locations. I didn't put up a copy of the tribute lists from Athens, but those who know about these, they're often referred to as tribute lists, as if they record all the tribute paid to Athens by its subject cities. Actually, they record that share of it that is dedicated to the god, the first fruits. And so a huge proportion of early inscriptions are effectively recording offerings. But then you get these more practical tables, and this is a Roman calendar, and although it's less pretty, it's easier to see how it works here. You've got months along the top, January, February, March, April, May. Do you see those? You've then got letters down which mark the number of days. So here you've got 27 and so on, and these are all days. And then, on particular days, these are the knowns, which occur on particular days each month. These are the ides. And occasionally, you'll be able to see in this religious festivals, here is the perilia. And Roman tradition says that originally the priests, who were all aristocrats, would simply announce when the days were, that they would devise this among themselves, and then they would say, right, well, this day is going to be... where's an example? This particular day will be nefas, you can't do business on it. And it's then a kind of popular political movement that insists that they publish in advance this. So knowledge is power in the sense of oral power, and then publication is making it more widely available. Occasionally you get really smart kinds of chronological notes. This is called a parapegma. There are quite a few parapegmas about. And what this one shows is, anyone want to guess who's on the top? The clue's in the number. It's the seven planetary deities. From the point of view of the ancients, there are seven planets. This comes from Babylonian law originally. That's the ones you can see, Mars, Venus, Jupiter, Saturn. They include the moon and the sun as them as well. Mercury as well. So that you can't see with the naked eye planets beyond Jupiter. And that's, of course, where we get the names of the days of the week. So Saturn for Saturday, Sun for Sunday, and so on. It works slightly better in French, I think. So these pegs here tell you what day of the week it is. These pegs here tell you what day of the month it is. And these enable you to track the zodiac. Pisces, Aries, Gemini, Cancer. So this is a system which allows people to know where they are in a set of different time systems, which don't recur. And we use this all the time, of course, the idea of a seven-day cyclical time for the week. You have a different time for the month. You have a different time for the zodiac and so on. And devices like this are put up. So if you were to think of my more inclusive idea of literacy as being able to use graphic visual systems, being able to make sense of that is a form of literacy. Being able to use a calendar is a form of literacy. And we do actually use this as a metaphorical sense all the time when we work. We talk about people having computer literacy, not meaning they can read writing when it's on a screen, duh, meaning that they can make their way around computer programs, have a kind of intuitive sense of how they work. And we even use emotional literacy as well, which I think is quite interesting, because it betrays a collective understanding of what psychologists would call theory of mind, that in order to communicate, you need to be able to roughly predict what things you say. You can tell, or you hope you can tell if someone's going to laugh at your jokes. You hope that you can tell when someone's really feeling aggressive towards you. And that kind of reading people's faces and so on, which of course some people can't do, which is at the basis of emotional literacy. So literacy is as competence in sign systems. The rituals that Romans carry out generate text. Not all of them. Many rituals don't. So pouring wine on an altar, burning a bit of animal flesh, these don't necessarily generate text. But there are texts that generate quite a few. I've listed four: votives, tituli, defixiones, and amulets. Now, votives, like this rather nice one, a votive cow, set up by Herodes Atticus, one of the least pleasant figures in Roman history, has his dedication on the back. And votives are offerings you make to the gods. Formerly in Roman religion, you promise the god something in advance in a conditional way. You say, if I come safe home, I will put up an altar to you. And then if you do come back home, you then put up an altar, and it ends with something with a sign, with something like VSLM. I fulfilled my vow, votum solvit, or he fulfilled his vow, because it's usually dedicated in the nominative. He fulfilled his vow. Libens, happily, willingly, merito, because the god deserved it. So, the god delivered. And there's even a whole set of practices which we can observe in a few rather rare texts where groups of priests come together and they say, well, a year ago, the Alpha Brethren's the key case here, a year ago, we promised that we would perform a sacrifice if the emperor was safe. Is the emperor safe? Yup. Now we perform the sacrifice. And occasionally, no, he wasn't, so we don't perform the sacrifice. It is a contractual relationship between gods and men. And so from that point of view, votives are quite important because they're traces of past transactions. Now, one might say, once you've paid your bill, why do you need to keep a trace of it? What are you going to do with all those irritating bits of paper they give you in a restaurant after you've paid? Well, one reason you put up monumental votives is you want to advertise that you're the kind of person who does pay your bill. Another reason, of course, is that priests would quite like you to advertise that their god is the kind of person who delivers. And the beauty of this system is that if the god doesn't deliver, there's no record, is there? So sanctuaries all around the Roman world have got healing cures, and no one ever says, I came to the god, I paid 40 pieces of gold, I slept in the sanctuary overnight, and my leg still hurts. So in practice, we have sanctuaries of the ancient world are full of writing. They're full of records of cures, records of votives. And it's not just sanctuaries either. If you looked at Roman inscriptions in Latin, the vast majority are either altars or their tombstones. In other words, the vast majority of monumental writing is put up in the course of a religious transaction, burying the dead, fulfilling your vows to the dead in the process, or a vow, in this case, to Jupiter Optimus Maximus, conservator. This, of course, is a painted-up replica. Keteris Deis and all the other gods. So it's covering all bases here for this person. And it's very SLM, solvit libens merito. He forgot to put votum and dates, consular dates. And versions of this appear all over the Roman Empire. It's shaped like an altar. This doesn't mean they're all used as altars. What on earth would you do with 200 altars in a rural sanctuary? You know, they're just. But what the monument of the altar does, is it memorialises a sacrifice that takes place once and once only. Why writing? Why not just leave an altar? The advantage of writing, it's partly, of course, to identify the god, and it's partly to identify the individuals concerned. In other words, writing is a way of inscribing individuals' identities into this activity. Here's a tombstone. They're not usually as gorgeous as this, but I thought I'd give you a nice one to look at before you see the more normal version. Typically, a Roman tombstone is set up to the shades of the dead, dies manibus. So in some sense, it's like a votive. It's being offered to the dead. It is a duty on an heir to commemorate the dead. Okay, we have a few quotations from people talking about how dreadful it is that heirs these days don't set up altars to their parents. It's usually a close family member. In the legions, it's quite often a fellow soldier because the family are somewhere else. Very occasionally, you'll get sort of more remote family members, presumably because close ones are not there. This, as you can see, is a nice family one, but once you get out into the wilds, it gets a bit more sort of basic. Dies manibus, here we are. So this is about the most basic version you can have, and that one is for a signifer. They're dotted all over the Roman Empire. Curse tablets too. People have been cursing since classical Greece, and the technology doesn't change very much. What you do is you get a sheet of lead. Why lead? We're not quite sure. Perhaps so you can roll it up. A lot of them are rolled up and then thrown into a well or pushed into a grave or hidden underground. And on it, you write a curse, which might be a very specific one. Or it might be to something like, whoever took my iPod charger, be it male or female, slave or free, Gaul or Greek, I can sign this person to the gods of the underworld to tear and rend. And that's the sort of text you get, except, of course, obviously not the iPad. And they pop up a lot. They pop up in Crete, they pop up in Greece. We have quite a few from South Wales, from the West Country. This technology is probably used everywhere around the Roman Empire. I don't know. Well, we'd never know, would we? I mean, if you sling it into the bottom of a pond in Bath, it would be a major exercise to go down the bottom and get yours out and do it. And you might just be a bit embarrassed. And we don't even know if people knew they'd been cursed. I mean, maybe you curse, and some of them are cursing unknown people. Literally, whoever stole my cloak is one from Bath. So I don't know if they can be reversed, but of course, it's also one of those classic things where at least no evidence. If you reverse it, then we haven't got something to work with. But it's nice. It's a nice idea. Amulets. Vast range of amulets. Some of them written on stone tools from the Neolithic, like the one on the left. Some of them on gems. Some of them on pieces of metal. Some have text within them. I chose these two partly because I just love the look of Anubis up there. Quite often they have gods on them, but they're often rather unconventional ones. So here we have Yao and Sabaoth. So these are Hebrew names which have been incorporated in Greek script. Yao is Yahweh. And put with this horrendous hybrid god. And there's various other texts. Some of them are well known and some of them are palindromes that go back and forth, which are often thought to have some magical significance. the text is clearly important here as a means of... you're essentially freezing a spell and putting it around your neck. It's designed usually to protect you, to ward off other spells. So there's a whole range of magic in which writing is used on both sides. You curse, you protect from cursing. They're rather gorgeous, aren't they? Quite expensive, I imagine, too. Finally, writing as itself a ritual activity. We know that not all drinking and not all eating is ritual eating and drinking, but we know we can make it into ritual eating and drinking. And this is one of the most common ways in which ritualization takes place in the wider world. Sometimes it's by eating a particular thing or not eating a particular thing that makes it ritual. Sometimes you say certain prayers beforehand. Sometimes a banquet has taken place in a particular place. Greek sanctuaries typically have dining rooms attached to them, because when you sacrifice to the gods, you will then go and eat together. Sometimes you eat the meat you've actually sacrificed. It's been pointed out to me recently by a few people who tried this experimentally that killing an animal... there's quite a long time between killing, say, a pig or a cow and being able to actually eat the meat. You know, there's a lot of butchering and preparing and so on. So maybe we're sometimes seeing people go through an animal sacrifice and then eating pre-prepared food or whatever. And occasionally you find trace of this, a recent excavation of a large Mithras shrine in the Low Countries. Turns out the entire place is full of chicken bones, even though all the iconography about Mithras is all about killing the bull and rejuvenating the earth. So they go through this huge sort of bull, God kills bull, earth is reborn type stuff, and then it all descends into Nando's. But somehow or other, it's meaningful for them. And so the question is, yeah, we know other things can be ritualized, particular styles of dress, speech, and so on. And writing's no different. And so we have some examples where the actual writing appears to be itself part of a ritual. Curse tablets are case in point. People really do seem to actually need to write the curse themselves, which tells you something about who can read and write. You can't just buy one off the shelf, which surprised me. VSLM, well, not the writing there because it's carved by a professional stone merchant. But it's been pointed out by Mary Beard, in fact, one of her articles, that when we have these sanctuaries which have votives or other documents there, or titulae, which are temporary notices, white boards with stuff painted on them for a short time only, that this is one of the very few ways in which people in the ancient world can express a particular individual sense of attachment. You know, we have other ways of being members of religious groups. Go to a particular place of worship, go to the temple, you make your contribution, you attend major festivals with your co-religionists. When it's not so clear that many ancients operated that way, but writing their name and leaving it up at the sanctuary in one way or another is itself a way, perhaps, of inserting yourself into a set of social relationships, your brothers and your children and your wives and your patrons, but also the gods. Bringing the gods into that society and putting yourself in the society of the gods through putting names together in sacred texts. And then we have this extraordinary bit of the Arval Acta, which is excavated in... it's an excavated shrine outside Rome, about halfway between Rome and Fiumicino Airport, at the rather grotty suburb of La Mariana. There's nothing to see there anymore. But from the 19th century, huge numbers of documents have turned up from the sacred grove, the Grove of Dea Dea, where an extremely elite priesthood named the Arval Brethren, who claimed to be the brothers of Romulus, perform rituals of enormous complexity. Here's just a brief account of one of them. We know they're enormous complexity because they wrote them all down. That's not at all clear why they would write them down, nor are they written down in a sort of standard format on tablets. They're written everywhere, on the stone benches, on the altars, on the walls, every free bit of space. They're writing down their acts, their religious activity, and they're writing it down in enormous detail. So this is just one extract you've got here. 14 days from the calendar of June, AD 87, in the Grove of Dea Dea, and then... in the master, when Gaius Julius Silanus was master, when Gaius Nonius Bassus Salvius Liberalis was in charge, was actually the prefect, the Arval Brethren perform a sacrifice. And as you see, it goes through, it says, who sacrificed? In this case, it's a rather bizarre one. They've had to pollute the grove anyway because trees have fallen down and they've had to cut cut the trees and removed them. But that means taking iron into the sanctuary, which entails pollution, and so you then need to perform an expiation of this afterwards. And it's all done in enormous detail, including where they ate and what they have for dinner and all the rest of it and so on. And look to how many names are there, how often these super elite, only about 12 Arval brethren probably at any one time, how they're all inserting the names wherever they're, explicitly say what function they hold that year. So here it's been suggested that the actual writing, covering this shrine with writing, so it would have, it's almost like the sort of Romanes Aeunt Domum type wall in the Life of Brian, that this is itself a ritual activity. One sign of this is that the texts start quite short. We've got sequences over nearly 300 years, and the early ones are quite short. And as they go on, they get more elaborate and bigger and more sort of, you know, intrusive into normal spaces. So maybe writing itself could be ritualised. I haven't got a very nice slide of it, but this just gives a sense of, you know, it's not lovely, beautiful, big, easy to read, monumental letters. It's just sort of all over the place. And it's the life and work of John Scheit to have edited and produced them. One debate John Scheit, a retired professor of College de France, has got involved in is a big debate about whether there's also a category of text that we no longer have, which told you how to do Roman religion. Were there recipe books? Were there liturgical guides which would tell you what to do? The way that is quite familiar in many modern religions, not all, but many modern religions do have texts which tell you what you should do on what day. And the answer is almost certainly not. The nearest thing we have is we have these sort of Orphic prayers, but they're usually found in graves, and they're often very mysterious. They would be useless recipe books to people who didn't already know what they say. So they're not good guides in the way that you know, ordinary prayer book might be. How did they know then? Well, one way they knew is that things are passed down through doing. Societies remember because groups who include members of more than one generation take part in collective festivals at regular intervals. And who was it wrote that wonderful book of how societies wrote? Connaughton, Paul Connaughton. And he talks about how societies which don't use writing to educate people, they pass on knowledge because young people do it with older people and they keep doing it many times. And certainly priesthoods, you might be recruited in your early 20s, you might still be a priest if you're still alive in your 70s. So there's routines of learning, of apprenticeship, if you like. And much of this will have been done orally, just like those original Roman priests who wouldn't tell people when it was the Ides until it sprang on them. That within these very sort of exclusive, mostly elite groups of religious authorities, oral tradition and embodied knowledge and learnt habits are probably much more important than texts. Yeah, so we shouldn't imagine that one day in the Shrine of the Arvals we'll find the bluffer's guide to sacrificing to the emperor. I mean, as if they couldn't read all the furniture around them. Well, that's one of the other interesting things about the Arval Brethren Acts is every ritual is slightly different. No text duplicates the other exactly. Every time you reinvent slightly differently. Clifford Ando has actually argued that religious knowledge is very important in Rome. For a long time, classes had a kind of shorthand saying the ancient world's all about orthopraxy, doing the right thing, and Christianity is all about orthodoxy, knowing the right thing. And Ando pointed out that you need to know an awful lot to do the right thing. But that Roman religious knowledge consists of knowledge of how to do ritual. It doesn't consist of a set of propositions about which god is descended from which other god, about which they seem blissfully uninterested. And they're about as interested in the afterlife as most people today, really. It's a very sort of Christian viewpoint that you have very, very precise views about the afterlife, which you debate and argue. Most of my Jewish friends say they've no idea what's going to happen to them when they're dead. They'll be dead, so why they worry about it? It's very Epicurean in a way. And there's also the case that, you know, you have those extraordinary Buddhist cemeteries out in East Asia, where people who apparently believe they're going to be constantly reborn still find it necessary to put up a tombstone like everybody else. You think, well, what's going on there? You know, is it splitting or what? we do, of course, have magical recipes for spells, the magical papyri, which tell you how to do all sorts of weird and wonderful things. Only from Egypt, only a few examples, but quite interesting because they clearly do include genuine Egyptian traditions. I've been talking very much of Roman as if it's a single tradition, but many other things flow into it. Cursing, curse tablets, clearly is something that starts from the Greek world and spreads. A lot of the Egyptian magical material is known as Hermetica, meaning associated with the god Hermes. But this is Hermes Trismegistos, Hermes the thrice great. And the title thrice great was first applied to Thoth. And Thoth is an Egyptian god of knowledge and magic. And the Book of Thoth is a huge item in Egyptian mythology. So we're seeing the Book of Thoth, Thoth three times great, Hermes Trismegistos, much easier to say it in the Greek, get flowing through into Roman period activities. I should have started, I suppose, by saying that the Roman Empire doesn't start from scratch, that there are many literate traditions flowing into it. I wonder, the last part, just talk a bit about writing about religion. What I'm not going to talk about in detail is about how religion features in literary works, although in an odd way that's been one of the big areas of interest, that people have stopped editing out the myth and religion and saying, oh, well, that's just, we can ignore that, it's really all about heroes and killing and so on, and to take religion much more seriously when it appears in classical poetry. And this is the book I forgot to put on the reading list, well, many I forgot, but Dennis Feeney's book on literature and religion in Rome is an amazing starting point for that. Romans did write about religion, and so did Greeks. Most of the Greek texts about religion, explicit about religion, are gone, except for those written in the Roman period. From the Roman period, we have some accounts in historical writing, in Fabius Pictor, the first Roman historian, in Livy, in others, which describe rituals in a level of detail which suggests that people are quite interested in them. This is maybe not surprising, since most of the people who wrote Roman texts are very near the top of the Roman elite, and they monopolise ritual authority and power. So senators, well, many, in a sense, senators are the religious collective religious authority of the Roman state. All the colleges of priests are staffed entirely by senators. A sign of how important this is that when they move to emperors, the first emperor has himself quietly made a member of every single college of priests. So no college of priests is ever going to meet without the emperor maybe being present or maybe not. It just sort of quietly affects how you run things. There are textbooks which try to work out the origins of Roman customs. Varro, who's a slightly older contemporary of Cicero, wrote an enormous one, which almost none of which has survived, but it was so authoritative that it becomes the main target for Augustine in the City of God. So if we reconstruct Varro, his account of Rome religion, by reading a highly hostile witness, Augustine, who nevertheless gives us a very clear idea of quite how much is in the book. He's particularly interested in names of gods, rituals, times, places, ceremonies, and so on. A great handbook. And by the late Republic, we have the names of some people like Nigidius Figulus. We also have some of Cicero's works on the nature of the gods, on divination. We have the works of Lucretius, which is an a-religious philosophy, a materialist account in which the gods are made a matter of the same as our souls are, but a very different view of the cosmos. And then Verrius Flaccus is behind some of those calendrical things. So Romans are interested in ritual, and they write about it. But what they write is it's not scripture, it's not authoritative. There's no sense in which people say, well, Nigidius Figulus said this, that must be true. It hasn't even got the kind of status that in some Christian tradition the writings of the fathers have, or the way in which in Jewish traditions some of the commentaries on the Jewish Bible, or indeed in Islamic traditions also, where the surahs have a kind of secondary authority. Cicero can say what he likes about divination. If he's wrong, he's wrong, and people aren't worried by it. And there's nothing wrong with saying he's wrong either. And the same is true even for Varro. Varro's held up by Augustine as the most learned of the Romans, and he quotes Cicero in a Cicero dialogue, posterior analytics, I think, saying to Varro, who's a character in this dialogue, we were strangers in our own city until you came along. So this sense that your Romans are wandering around doing all this stuff and they've no idea why or when and what it means. And so antiquarian activity is not recording facts from the past, it's discovering facts for the first time, which, given their methods and their evidence, is a little bit scary. We also have philosophical writings of various kinds. Plutarch on Isis and Osiris certainly includes a fairly accurate account of the Osiris myth, in which he's killed and dismembered, his body is recaptured. Both the two Plutarch works I've named up there are highly influenced by Platonism, an idea that there are sort of lesser gods, daimons, mortal beings that live for hundreds and hundreds of years, and that what the ancients thought were gods, Mars, Venus, Athena, Apollo, are actually daimons, and behind them all is a much more satisfactory god, a god who doesn't fall in love with mortals or have hissy fits or get wounded in battle, a great sort of unknowable god. And the Platonic god, of course, influences some of the early Christian versions of God in that sense. And Neoplatonic texts, which had such an impact on Augustine's spiritual development, could be thought of as, in some sense, religious texts. There's a lot of writing one could recruit if you wanted to look at ancient writing about ritual and ancient writing about religious traditions. The point is, no more authoritative than people writing about Homer's geography. These are learned speculations. You might admire the scholarship, but there's nothing, it's not freighted with anything else. And so it's very different from the set of traditions that we're familiar with appearing from some point in the end of the first millennium BC in the Near East. First of all, presumably, with Jewish scripture, although there is, of course, an alternative version which Zoroastrian stuff comes first. And almost immediately spinning off all sorts of other texts, the Samaritan Bible, the materials from Qumran, the Christian texts. And what these things have in common, which distinguishes them from the classical canon, is that the texts themselves are really important. The texts themselves have an authority that is not related to their authors, that you might challenge somebody who've got the text wrong. You do kind of textual criticism. What you can't say is that what's behind, you don't say, oh, well, you know, oh, I suppose we do now. We say, oh, well, Paul was fine, but he was rubbish with women or something like that. But at least in the way in which texts are being used in this period, once something is regarded as in this rather special set of texts, which we call scripture, they don't have a collective word for, these texts are in some sense untouchable. You have to deal with them other ways. You have to claim their fault, that claim people got the wrong version, or you have to claim that they're allegorical or something like that. In a way that people do try these techniques on Homer, but nothing's at stake really. It doesn't matter whether Homer's allegorical or not, because it's just a poet, a great poet, but no more than that. I put these down here in order to show how this new fashion of using writing and religion has spread very rapidly. That throughout the Near East and well beyond it, Marnie's text found all the way from North Africa to India within a few generations of the time they're written. Of course, they later end up all over the inland frontier of China as well. This is also probably the period at which Zoroastrian texts are codified. Controversial, particularly among Zoroastrian scholars, some of whom claim that they're effectively composed about 1800 BC and remembered without a single word changing for all that period. And those of us who work with classical texts and know how badly mangled things get, oral texts get in just a few generations, we find that quite hard to believe. But many Zoroastrian scholars, maybe some of you in the room are more expert in Zoroastrian than I am, which would not be difficult, are aware of this use to it. But when we first begin to get certain signs that they're being written down in definitive versions, it's happening at the same time as Christian texts have become beginning to find something like the canon, and also the way in which they're talked about. So many early martyr texts involve people being asked whether they've got texts and being refusing to surrender them or surrendering them, the traditores, and then wanting forgiveness afterwards. So the texts themselves have become special in the same way in which they become special in what I call fetishizing the text. Yeah. The way in which texts buried in kinesis in medieval Egypt, other parts of the Islamic world. What is a copy? When Alan Bowman and I were editing the book Literacy and Literacy and Power, we had a discussion with Martin Goodman, had an interesting argument. So he's trying to work out how much of a text is a copy. And there's eventually Martin, because he's enormously learned, found that it's not like 27 letters. 27 letters in a row that also occur in that sequence in scripture means that extract is scripture. Yeah, 26 isn't, 28 definitely is. So you have to have some kind of boundary to bring it in. By fetishize the text, I don't mean anything weird or bizarre. What I mean is that texts are taken to be, the physical objects, material texts, are taken to be objects of enormous significance, treasures, relics, things that are of great care, things that you will talk about, argue about, and that you'll even depict. And this is perhaps a closing slide. It's one of the most wonderful images of this. I know this is one of the... there's a series of synagogues that have amazing mosaics in around the Holy Land. They're all late antique. So they're imitating the dramatic burst of mosaics being created in Christian building, which only happens after Constantine. And you can just see, I hope, here, there's a bit of a zodiac wheel. And you can also, I hope, see that it's got Hebrew letters now for the Hebrew names for the signs of the zodiac. But I'm really interested in showing you this, which is the Third Temple. And within this, you're seeing Torah scrolls. So you actually portray scrolls. And now, this isn't something the Romans particularly got about the Jews for a very long time. When you look at their symbols on coins or on the Arch of Titus for the destruction of Jerusalem, it's the menorah, it's symbols of the temple itself. And the Tacitus account doesn't mention scrolls at all. But clearly here, you've got menorahs, you've got all sorts of strange animals as well, but you've also got a portrayal of the Ark with the scrolls in it. The point to come back to at the end is that if you're thinking about literacy and writing in contexts, that every religion in the ancient world that we know of, and I could have started if I had more in-depth competence with probably with dynastic Egypt, in fact, and even I could have started the Epic of Gilgamesh, since near the end of the Epic of Gilgamesh it says, and he set up his travels on great tablets for people to read. So inside the text of Gilgamesh is an account of the setting up of the text of Gilgamesh. So the materiality of that text is foregrounded right from the start. This is a consciously post-oral mode of composition, just like the Homeric poems are rather later. But the context within which writing is used vary enormously. My impression is that over time, the range of things carry on. That cursing people don't stop cursing when they invent scripture. And they carry on putting up tombstones, even when you're no longer worshipping the Dies Manibus, the shades of the dead. And so the uses of writing get extended about, and they move rapidly from one confessional faith group to another, if you can use those terms appropriately in late antiquity, which I rather doubt. But what you do see is writing being, along with imagery and other symbol systems, a pretty central part of most ancient religious practice. Thank you very much for your attention.